Hello, I'm Thomas Yearsley, and I'm here at Oosterhout at the RMG Analog Tape Factory. A bit behind me. You'll see it in a minute. We'll go inside and have a quick tour of it.
Please mind the step.
This is the lacquer area. Okay.
The step is, because if we have a fire, which luckily I have never experienced, automatically this place is wetted by the sprinklers, and to avoid the water getting into the sewer system, into the ground,
right,
we have the barrier to avoid that. So all the water will stay here and will put out the fire here. The process starts off in the meter. That is one of the parts we took from MTEC, which is very, very important. And this meter is, in principle, it's the same as that is being used in a bakery to make the dough. Only this one is a little bit bigger. The kneading of the material makes a very homogeneous mass at high solvent, at high solid content, and will compact the magnetic particles inside, enhancing the sensitivity of the tape in the end. A kneader will do that, but it will not take all the needles apart. If you buy the magnetic pigment, part of the needles are clustered together, and you need to take them apart to have the optimum result for the magnetic tape later on. And that is done in bead mills. Bead mills are filled with beads. Let's have a look if I have some. Yep. This is zircon silicium oxide, filled for approximately 44% in the mill. Lacquer is pumped through the mill. There's a spindle inside which rotates at high speed, and the collisions between the beads, if there is an agglomerate of magnetic particles in between, will break up the needles to get the free needles needed for the magnetic recording. Yeah. Of course, we only have a limited amount of mills, and to break up every particle would require an endless line of mills, which is of course economically not feasible. So when the majority of the particles have been taken apart, there is only a very small portion of still agglomerated pigment, which is taken out by filtration. The vessels you see here contain solvents, contain binder solutions, which are used in the production process. To take out the last particles which would cause problems, the lacquer is pumped through filters like this. This is filters which have the normal ones we use. Will not allow any particle bigger than 20 micron to pass through the filter. So in the end we have a very homogeneous lacquer without particles over 20 microns in size. If you have any questions, please feel free to interrupt me.
I'm following this well.
Okay, if after filtration the lacquer is fully ready, has the right for production, only thing done is quality control. It is checked on viscosity and salt content. And if you would make a mistake in the preparation of the lacquer, that would directly give either a completely false viscosity or a completely false salt content. And it's almost impossible to make a mistake, make another mistake, and end up with the right viscosity and the right solid content. So the check of both those parameters guarantees that the lacquer is according to the formulation as been developed. We have, in principle, we have two factories. This one, where we now, is a very old factory. It was built in the early 70s. And even though it was still operational, the main problem of this facility was that it was economically unfeasible.
Mm-hmm.
So what we did in the end, beginning of the 90s, was build a new coater which was economically much more feasible. And that is the coater we used for our production. So that is also why they are dismantling this part of the factory. The process here, the coating starts off with the base film. Mm-hmm. The base film we buy from suppliers in Asia and Europe.
Is this it?
This is a very thin one. Mm-hmm. This is for this is the thick one. So we have the thin ones going from 5 micron up to 12 micron. And then for the studio products we use either 20 micron or 30 micron film, depending on the product. This coater was, as said, developed for videotape production. It has a width of 660 millimeters, 26 inches.
Mm-hmm.
Maximum speed at which it can be operated is 800 meters a minute, 2500 feet a minute.
Uh-huh.
It can be operated continuously, no interruption at changeover of rolls. It can change the rolls on flight at the maximum speed, which is a speed which was applicable for videotape. Videotape has a very, very thin coating layer.
Mm-hmm.
The product we produce now are produced at much lower speeds.
Mm-hmm.
So first stage is unwinding the base film roll. Product is corona treated. Corona treatment is a plasma treatment which in principle makes the wetting of the coating of the base film surface improves the wetting of the base film surface to allow for a very homogeneous coating thickness in the end. Next stage is the coating, the actual coating stage. The lacquer is brought from the lacquer factory to here, is pumped in a temporary vessel, is once again filtrated and is pumped to the coating head, which at this moment is not attached. Floating head is a very large block of steel with a very, very tiny slit. And lacquer is pushed into a chamber behind the slit and pushed out of the slit and comes out very homogeneously. And as the flow to the coating head is constant and the tape speed is constant, you get a very constant coating thickness. You can apply either magnetic product, the front side of the tape. In that case, there is a magnet behind the tape which attracts the magnetic lacquer to the base film, which makes it very, very homogeneous. This is a blowing unit. It blows the tape against the coating head, which is used if we do backside coating with a non-magnetic coating. Of course, then the magnetic, the trick with the magnet won't work because it's non-magnetic. Next step is orientating the needles. The magnetic paint consists of needles in the binder system, and to get the optimum results magnetically, you need to align the particles as much as possible in the direction of the tape, which is the direction in which the signal will be written later on. It's done by magnets, and the next stage is drying the product.